thank you so much giving me this opportunity and sharing my career journey, my experience, my learnings. I think, I would like to kind of touch upon something from my childhood. I was born in Srinagar. I am from that beautiful land of Kashmir. And I spent fairly decent amount of time in Kashmir, and then I moved to Jammu. And you know what happened in Kashmir and why all of us had to move to a place which was not our own place. I think that was an interesting milestone in my life. That was the biggest milestone, I would say, because I was pretty young. I was hardly 10 years of age when we were put to a situation where we had to, you know, start life from a scratch. So from a comfort zone to a completely new zone where, as a child, you wouldn't want to be in a zone. So I think that phase was a great learning phase, because we became independent. We started learning things on our own. Parents had no time because they had to start everything from a scratch. I think we became fairly independent. I as a child, if I start comparing myself and I try to connect the dots, I feel I was fairly an independent child. Even though I come from a very humble background, my parents are not seasoned professionals, but I think that kind of gave me an opportunity, that period gave me an opportunity to be on my own and learn and explore new things. From there, when I moved to, I did my engineering. That was another very interesting journey, because I moved from an urban city to a village where, a very different environment, different language, from a comfort zone to an uncomfortable zone where language was new, everything was new, you were strange. So I think engineering days were also interesting for me, because I learned so much from it. And when I decided to do MBA, I my journey is pretty normal, but I have tried to make it extraordinary by my all hard work. And I think everything that happened in my life kind of contributed in a way which I think, when I connect the dots today, every phase in my life, even though it was pretty normal, but everything contributed in a way which made everything so interesting. Nasik, I did my MBA from Nasik, from a college affiliated to Pune University. And then, during the campus interview, there were only sales jobs that were offered to us, because I did not come from the top tier one, tier two college. So it was just another college affiliated to Pune University. So then I said, no, I'm not planning to do sales. I'll not take up any campus interview. I'll look out for my job on my own. So I started applying to companies. I started this search on my own, and I applied to Himalaya Drugs. You know, there was some opening in Nokri, I believe, and I applied. And I think that was one of the very interesting starting points in my career. Because Himalaya at that time was at that stage where they were moving from a predominantly old fashioned style of branding to a new era, because the third gen had kind of joined the business, and the brand was taking a new turn, completely new turn. I joined them, and I was given the retail marketing. So I had to set up exclusive shop in shops of Himalaya stores in Mumbai. And then it was quite challenging, because these shop in shops were not to be opened in malls. They were to be opened in unconventional places like hotels, your gymnasiums, or your spas, or those unconventional places. So the idea that the brand had, that they wanted to increase the footprint of retail footprint of the brand. And I think that was an interesting journey because I got exposed to a brand which was winning awards for its packaging and retail makeover that they had. So I think I learned a lot. I worked very closely with the packaging firm that was working on the brand, and I think that gave me a complete new dimension that yes, I think you know, if you get a chance to work hard and if you get a chance to you know, work in a space which is very challenging, because I had to go and kind of meet the probable partners who said, why you want a shop in shop outlet in a hotel? Who will buy? And these hotels were not predominantly the 5-star hotels. These were budget hotels or any hotel where you had to convince them to buy the stock. It was not that you were putting the stocks on consignment. You had to convince them to buy the stock, invest in the retail space. I think that was pretty challenging because first you had to convince them to buy the stock and then also, you know, invest in everything around that unit. So that was pretty challenging, but I think I learned a lot. And how to build a brand also, because both the things were happening at the same time. We were doing opening retail stores, we were opening shop in shops. How to create that footprint across the India? I think that was an interesting journey. And then I moved to another very interesting brand, Health Total. It is India's pioneering brand in the space of health and nutrition. So I spent decent amount of time. I learned all the marketing tidbits there. Then I moved to Hindustan Pencils, which is India's leading stationery major. I spent close to 7 years there. I think I learned how to scale up what you learn in your early days of career. So I learned at Hindustan whatever I learned at Himalaya Drug Company and at Health Total, I could scale up in this organization because it has footprints across 53 countries globally. And you work on a scale where the retail distribution is humongous. So anything, any idea that you conceive, it has to happen across the length and breadth of the country. So that's where, you know how to scale up things. I think moving from a small space to a space which is so big, I think you kind of learn a lot. And I remember now you have everybody saying that girls are doing this and girls are doing that. But I remember at that time when I joined Hindustan Pencil in 2007, traveling to a tier 3 town was a big challenge. And especially when you have to go to places like Bihar, UP, or those places where still, a female coming and speaking with a retail store owner is a big thing. So I think, but I overcame all those challenges. I was the only girl when I was recruited for this role. I was the only marketing person in the organization as a female lead. So I think that was another challenge, I think, which gave me another dimension to explore, where you have to overcome gender bias. You have to be out there and prove your mettle. You know, market is tough. Market is very strange to you. So you have to kind of go beyond all that and put in a lot of hard work in order to succeed and prove yourself. I think that has been a phenomenal journey. I really learned so much there. Then I moved to Tata Blue Scope, a Tata Group, and Tata Group Company, where I I think I was able to work in an environment where, you know, you have two players who are amazingly big, like Tata's and BlueScope. These were giants. And then you know, work on a very different scale, where you have cross-country fusion happening of the strategies and policies. So you kind of learn very different nitty-gritties of marketing at that scale. Everything that happened in my life, as I said, it was pretty normal, but then I tried to make it interesting by putting a lot of hard work. That's what I think everybody needs to do, to put in a lot of hard work to kind of make it interesting for yourself and for everybody who is there around you. And finally, when I realized it's the time for me to start my own marketing and consulting firm, took up this decision that yes, finally, you know, I'm in this space. My daughter is grown up. She's now 8 year old. So I can take up this challenge. So I thought of starting this brand, My Big Brand Story, because I felt that there is a need to convey the story, unique stories of various brands in an interesting way. And I had that amazing experience of traditional marketing and digital marketing because of my last assignments that I took up in the digital space. So I wanted to fuse both the learnings and offer interesting solutions to the brand partners. And that's how I thought of starting this My Big Brand Story. And like you, we also have a small initiative, like, where we try to cover the interesting stories of various successful entrepreneurs and these brands where they have some unique stories to tell. So this platform is Confab. We try to reach to interesting storytellers and try to convey their story. So that's how, we try to do our little bit. But I think what emerged in last 1 year, especially during COVID times, that all those brands who were in that myopic zone, like who had that marketing myopia that, no, I don't want to be in that space because it's not needed. I don't want to invest in digital because it's not needed. My traditional marketing is working. It's working pretty fine. I'm organizing events. I'm organizing trade shows. So I'm doing everything perfect. But then there came a zone when all of a sudden, all the brands had to, venture into a zone which was unheard of, right? The way we are interacting today. So it is, say 1 year back, it was unheard of, right? Now today is a norm. I think what I see as an interesting thing emerging is that conversational marketing is the trend. Brands want to engage. Brands want to have conversation with their audience. Audience wants to have a conversation with the brands. It's a two-way process. So it's a conversation, continuous conversation and engagement. And they want to have a fair amount of, audience wants to have a fair amount of response, decent amount of response, which they feel is real, authentic. There are no bots who are responding. Even though we know there are bots, there are chat bots, it's not technically possible to have a scalable model where you are having real-time conversations with your audience. But then these bots also need to have stronger algorithms in place where the conversations are looking real, authentic. It's not option 1, 2, 3. Select option 1, 2, 3, no. The algorithms have to be so refined that conversations are looking real. Then I think the second trend I see emerging is, we have heard of it's augmented reality, virtual reality, MR. Now it is the time of extended reality. So extended reality is going to be a big thing. And I think that's what we want. And especially in today's scenario, if imagine we are going to have COVID dominating this space for another 5 years, what are you going to do? So if your audience is not keen on moving to actual stores and experiencing the product, what will you do? So can you sit and not create those models where you are creating the real experience for the audience, where they can see the product, where they can experience the product? I think that's something that we need to kind of really remember. That's critical, that's important. Third thing I feel what is important is brands need to be socially conscious. We need to create a story for the audience where the audience feels, yes, the brand is conscious, it's socially conscious, and it's real. Whatever it's saying, it's real, authentic. Look at how celebrities are now keeping everything open for everyone. Like, we are living in a naked world today. Gone are the days where you could put a veil and then you could have that pretend a pretentious kind of an image where you are trying to be guided by the PR agencies. No, it's not, no more like that. You have to be real, authentic. And then I think another thing that I feel is very critical and important is, I think, how brands are going to ensure that their audience is fairly trusting them as far as it goes in terms of data privacy and security, because I think that's fairly important. Big players like Facebook also were questioned. So I think, when it comes to smaller brands, if every now and then we have these platforms emerging where they're offering that collaborate with us, you can list your store, you can do X number of things. But then the question that a brand has, okay, I put my data on your platform, is it going to be real? Is it going to be saved? Is it going to be secure? Because my audience is going to question me. I am putting, they are trusting me. So my entire trust lies in your capability in ensuring that data is secure. And another thing interesting thing I would like to share here is that gone are the days of IDA model. Now we have ISIS model, which has search and sharing as the important component. So I think unless and until your content is shareable, unless and until your brand is searchable, I think you have lost the plot. So that's what you need to keep in mind then when you're planning your strategies, that this is what is required and this is the hygiene. I've still not covered upon those things which would come under the evolved parameters. These are hygiene level things that all the brands need to think in these directions. So I think looking at my entire journey, I would like to summarize very interesting things that I have learned. I think whatever you learn, it doesn't go waste. I think when you now connect the dots, like at present, when you connect the dots and look backwards, I think you will see that whatever you have learned or whatever you have done has actually helped you reach where you are. So I think at every stage, you need to give your 100%. Any project that is given to you, you need to think out of the box, be creative, be innovative in making that simple thing very interesting. it could be a project which is given to you where you are told, okay, go and stand in the exhibition and create something for the audience, which is interesting. Then how do you create value? How do you create value at every stage of your career or every stage of your life for yourself, for your family, for your buddies, for your organization, or for that matter, for this country or for this environment or for this globe? So what are you doing? So where is the value addition happening? So this thought needs to be always there in your head. Am I adding value? Am I adding value every day? So this is something that I would like to kind of, you know, share with all of you here. And one more thing that I would also like to share is that I think one needs to be humble. One needs to accept everything that comes your way with humility. You need to have a lot of gratitude for whatever is given to you. You know, you can't have a lot of, a lot of biases, stereotypes. You have to break everything. As I said, we live in a naked world. We have to give up everything. Gender bias. You have to give up that you are somebody. When I started my big brand story, if I had this thing in my head that, oh, I was leading organizations, I don't think you would be ever able to interact with a mom and pop store who wants a solution. I don't think so. Because you'll always have a preconceived notion that you are somebody, you're great, you're wow. I think you have to be grounded, you have to be humble, you have to have a lot of gratitude in your life, which kind of makes you a complete human being. That's what I feel makes your journey and your contribution invaluable.